2015 Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture Series. For 33 years, this interdisciplinary lecture series has showcased the talent and depth of the faculty at Eureka College. Thanks to the generosity of the Noe family, represented here by Charlotte Noe, Dean Noe's wife. If you could please stand and recognize her. Thank you, Mrs. Noe. The Dean's Lecture Series was begun by Dean Jerry D. McCoy, which I don't think is here tonight. He started in 1980. The series was created to stimulate discussion among the college faculty and to offer enrichment to students and friends of the college. In 1992, the Dean's Lecture Series was renamed in honor of the late Dr. Clarence R. Noe, who served as academic dean from 1955 to 1977. The series continues through gifts made by family and friends. Throughout the 33-year history of the series, special emphasis has been given to lecture topics reaching across many academic fields. Tonight, we'll be hearing from Professor of History, Dr. Junius Rodriguez, on a matter of historic importance that occurred right here on the Eureka College campus. Dr. Rodriguez will trace the life stories, and family histories of three African-American students who enrolled at Eureka College in the fall of 1928. The students were part of the most racially diverse freshman class in the college's history up to that point. Coincidentally, it was the freshman class that included Ronald Reagan of Dixon, a future president of the United States. Now this story has gotten a lot of publicity lately because it's been picked up by the Associated Press, and so you're fortunate enough to hear this presentation directly from Dr. Rodriguez. So without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Junius Rodriguez, bearing witness in extraordinary times.
Working. Okay, gang. I think we need to begin with a few thank yous. Charlotte, it's always so good to see you, and I'm glad that you could be here tonight. I appreciate your gracious support of this college through the years and of this lecture series in particular, and it's always wonderful to see you on campus. So thank you for being here. I also have to thank four of my students who have been student researchers on this particular project, and two of the four are actually here this evening. But this past summer, Colin Ash, Kyle Keysweater, Christopher Rainey, and Meredith Tuttle worked on this research project and helped me to get started with finding some of the things that we'll be talking about this evening. And Meredith is here, Kyle is here, and I think they really deserve a round of applause because they they put their heart and soul into this project, and they got me started on something, on a story that's really good. And we didn't realize at the moment, but I think we found a gold mine. And hopefully you'll agree as we go through the presentation this evening. I also would like to specifically thank Tony Glass, Director of Mellick Library and College Archivist, because what Tony has done is really enabled us to do a level of research into the class of 1928, fall of 28, spring of 29. And we have discovered some things that no one has ever seen before. We've put some things together that no one has ever found before. And Tony is the kind of archivist who truly understands that the archives are there to tell a story, and he's given us the ability to do that, and so I appreciate the help that you've given us along the way. I consider you my partner in crime on this, so thank you, Tony. And one final thank you before we begin. Three families, the Stewart family, the Watts family, and the Wright family, have allowed me to tell their story. They've trusted me with part of their history. Part of it which is rich, deep, and fascinating, part of it which is sometimes painful. But along the way, they realize that their stories are intertwined, that these three families came together in this place and in many respects stayed together in their time beyond Eureka. And so through their partnership in talking to me, sharing images with me, telling stories to me, we've been able to put together the story that you're going to hear this evening and what hopefully is going to become something larger down the line. Bearing witness in extraordinary times. This past summer, I got the idea of writing a short article, a journal article, that was going to tell the story of these three students. And you might find it rather interesting. Gee, writing a journal article on three students, or for that matter, doing a dean's lecture on three students. You know, what's the deal? Why are these three students so unique? Why are they so significant? For one thing, these are students who were coming to Eureka College in the late 1920s, towards the tail end of what is known as the Harlem Renaissance. And one of the ideas that was a prevailing idea during the Harlem Renaissance was the creation of what Alan Locke had called the New Negro, an individual who was going to take a greater degree of responsibility for helping to bring about the liberation of people who were still being held down by the laws of their day. The idea that individuals were going to enter into the various disciplines, they were going to engage in discussion, they were going to help to transform society, they were going to develop a type of agency through which they would help to transition society forward. And so these three students are coming into Eureka College, the tail end of that Harlem Renaissance time. They are quite representative of what we might call the New Negro Movement. In addition to that, this was the first time that we had three students at Eureka College starting out as freshmen who were going to be making their way through as African-American students. We previously had had black students on campus, but they generally came here for about 2 years. They were what today we would call transfer students. And generally, they were studying particular things. They were studying to become ministers or to become missionaries. But here we have students who are coming here to study other things, to do other things. Now, the pictures that you see here, I like this array of pictures because all three of these photographs show these three students when they were about at age 21. The picture on the left is Udell Watts Jr., known as Lump Watts, and this was his high school graduation picture from Kewanee High School. The picture in the center is Willie Sue Smith, who we now know as Willie Sue Smith Stewart. This was her graduation photograph from Eureka College. Willie Sue was the first African-American woman to graduate from Eureka College. She was a graduate of the class of 1932. The gentleman on the right is William Howard D. Wright. William Wright. And this is his high school graduation picture from Springfield High School in Springfield, Illinois. You're going to see that, and when I get to the next slide, you're going to see that they were at different ages, which is why I think seeing them here as 21-year-olds sort of, you know, puts them all on an even level. But some of them were older than others, and each one of them is going to have their own fascinating story. I chose to use the Maya Angelou quote here, "There's no greater agony than bearing an untold story inside of you." Each of these students had a story that they had to tell, the story of who they were, their own identity. Each one of them had to bear witness to the story of who they were. To use a modern day phrase here, each one of them had to represent. And to use another modern day phrase, the swag level that each of these three students represented was really rather amazing, as you're going to find. These are extraordinary lives, extraordinary people, and we have to find out more about their story. I think there's one other way, though, that we can look at the Maya Angelou quote. "There's no greater agony than bearing an untold story inside of you." We might think of this on an institutional level as well, that we have so many stories inside of us that we must tell, stories that are yet undiscovered, but stories that must be told. One of the things that we know about the history of Eureka College is that from the very beginning until now, we've always been a small school. But in spite of being a small school, our narrative has always been greater than our metrics. We have stories to tell. We have to understand the narrative. We have to discover it. We have to tell it. And we have to do it with a sense of urgency. We have to do it with a sense of compassion. And we also have to do it with a sense of accuracy. In other words, find the facts, discover the facts, tell the story. This is what the Reagan Research Project that we've been working on for the past 2 years is designed to do. Just to give you a little bit of background on these three individuals, William Howard D. Wright is the oldest of these three students. You'll notice that he was born in 1903. So by the time that he started as a freshman at Eureka College in 1928, he was 25 years old. He's a 25-year-old freshman. Udell Watts Jr., born in 1907. Udell starts again as a freshman. He was 21 years old when he started college as a freshman at Eureka College. Willie Sue Smith Stewart, born in 1910. You'll notice her dates 1910 to 2011. She lives to be 101 years old. She is going to be the oldest living graduate of the class of 1932 when she passes in 2011. A curious fact to mention here, and we don't know the full story on this yet, but when Willie Sue died, her family was not really sure how old she was. And part of the reason is Willie Sue had played coy about this. She had never told them her age. But another thing that's really rather fascinating is the records that we had at Eureka College, and this could have just been a mistake when somebody wrote a number down, but the records that we had at Eureka College said that Willie Sue was born in 1916. Now, I would venture to guess that when she walked onto campus, nobody thought she was a 12-year-old girl. She didn't look like a 12-year-old girl. She didn't act like a 12-year-old girl. But the records that we had at Eureka College said that she was born in 1916. We now know, it's been well documented now, that she was born in 1910. And so she's actually about a year older than Ronald Reagan, who was another member of that particular class. Now, one of the things, my unique take as a historian is oftentimes I'll look at things from a different kind of perspective, try to sort of reassemble a story, ask questions that might be a little bit unusual. Oftentimes, when we have looked at these individuals, if we've looked at them at all in telling the story, it's been to expand our understanding of what was it like to be a college student when Ronald Reagan was here. You know, what was it like to be here back in the 20s and 30s and to go to school with Ronald Reagan? My way of looking at the world is, what would it have been like for Ronald Reagan to go to school with Willie Sue Smith, to go to school with Udell Watts, to go to school with William Howard D. Wright? Because it may be strange to think of it this way, but the images that you're seeing there are Ronald Reagan's first black friends. These are the first three African Americans that Ronald Reagan had a close relationship with. And one of the things that we do know is that he maintained a correspondence through the years with Willie Sue Smith as long as his health allowed. Unfortunately, most of that correspondence was lost as the result of a tornado that hit Paris, Texas back in the late 1980s. But there was correspondence throughout their lifetime between Ronald Reagan and Willie Sue Smith. There were telephone conversations, there were letters. There were telephone conversations between Ronald Reagan and Udell Watts. In fact, the men visited one another on occasion. We have not yet been able to document that Mr. Reagan kept contact with William Howard D. Wright. I think eventually we might find that to be the case. But as of this point, we can't say with certainty that he maintained contact with William Howard D. Wright. Now, in terms of how to approach this project and how to start researching these three lives, I decided to go with what I thought was going to be the hardest story first. And that was to tell the story of William Howard D. Wright. And the reason why I say it's the hardest story, we've heard a lot about Willie Sue Smith. I've heard people talk about Willie Sue for the last 20 years. And so I assumed that that story had already been researched, it had already been told, every fact about it was known. Well, down the line, you're going to see that that wasn't really the case. There's a whole lot we didn't know about Willie Sue. We knew something about Udell Watts because Ronald Reagan, in his first autobiography, actually gives a shout-out to Udell Watts. He mentions him by name and talks about football plays that happened in a game against Illinois College and a record that Udell should have, but it somehow didn't make it into the record books. So we know something about Udell. We know something about Willie Sue, but in the case of William Howard D. Wright, we only had a name to go on. And so this past summer, when we first went down to Springfield to do research, we wanted to find out more about this guy. And what we suddenly discovered is it was going to be complicated because it just so happens there were two people in Springfield right about the same age, both African American, both named William Wright. It's a common name, Bill. Okay? And this was really confusing because William Wright was like Superman. He was all over the place. You know, everywhere that we were looking, we were finding William Wright references until we finally realized that there were two of them. And we finally had to figure out who was the right person. No pun intended. We had to find out who was the right person and then move on from there. Once we discovered who the right person was, it would become easy to tell the story. Now, the image that you're looking at is the class of 1928, fall of 1928. That's the entire Eureka College student body. Totals about 220 or so people back in the day. And this is a very historic image because this is the student body that would go on strike in late November, early December of 1928. This is the student body that through our research, we believe brings Eureka College into the era of modernity. The strike had many issues that we won't really get into tonight. That's not the purpose of this talk. But one of the things that's rather unique in this image is, oops, didn't want to do that. There we go. Right over here, you see Udell Watts. Right over here, you see William Wright. And right there is Willie Sue Smith. These three African-American students are all there. They're not all grouped together in the same location. They are integrated within the student body of 220 students who were here at the time. And they took this picture probably, I would imagine, in October. It was about maybe a month or so before the strike occurred in 1928. You'll notice the building right over here that you all recognize. This is the chapel. That building was made very historic during the time of the strike because this is where the midnight meeting was held. And in that midnight meeting, the bell, the college bell rang. Students came from the residence halls. They came from the community. They came to gather and ultimately to decide that they were going to vote to go on strike. A freshman from Dixon by the name of Dutch Reagan gave a speech, and that speech helped to sort of seal the deal to make sure that the students would vote with their feet and go on strike. And in the meantime, between when they held that vote to go on strike and when the student leaders of the strike movement were writing up basically the document, the ultimatum that they were going to turn over to the Board of Trustees, something had to be done to sort of fill the void, to fill the gap. And so the music professor, Professor George Gunn, got up to the microphone and he started singing. And what he chose to sing were old Negro spirituals. Now, everyone around the room was probably joining into the singing, but I would imagine that for three students who were in that crowd, there was a different message that was being heard. Because they knew that they were doing something that was risky. They knew that they were doing something that was dangerous. They knew that the times might be against them. But they were ready to cross the Jordan because there was a promised land on the other side. And as far as they were concerned, there was no man who could hinder their progress because they knew that Jesus was a powerful man. They were willing to enter the fight. They were willing to enter the fray. They knew that those songs spoke to them. It spoke to their heart. It spoke to their soul. And they understood, perhaps better than anyone else, the dangerous waters that they were about to cross. These three students were educational pioneers. They were risk takers. Robert and Minnie Wright were the parents of William Howard D. Wright. The picture on the left shows Robert when he was about in his 40s. The picture on the right, and I apologize, the quality of that is not very good, but that was from the obituary of Minnie Wright when she died at age 79. This couple married in 1898. They moved to Springfield, Illinois shortly after they married. They were originally from Kentucky. And one of the reasons, the principal reason why they came to Illinois in 1898 was because Robert was a coal miner. And there was a need for coal miners in Illinois because many coal miners had joined something called a union. And what companies were trying to do is they were trying to break up the union. And so one of the things they did is they brought in large numbers of African-American coal miners. And so Robert Wright was one of those coal miners who was brought in the late 1890s. Lived in Springfield, and in the early years was not a member of the union, but as time went on, did join the United Mine Workers. So eventually he did become a union miner. Minnie would become a remarkable person in the Springfield community in her own right. She eventually became the president of the Springfield Colored Women's Club. And at her home, she would hold special events associated with the organization that she belonged to. The other thing that's especially remarkable about Robert and Minnie Wright is that they raised 5 sons. And every one of their sons graduated from high school. Now, back in the day, for an African-American family that was living in Springfield, Illinois, this is remarkable. 5 sons raised, all 5 would go to high school. The want ad that you see there is an actual want ad that appeared in a 1903 newspaper. By this time, Minnie Wright was already a married woman with 2 children, but to try to find work, she had to identify herself as a colored girl. So this colored girl, this married woman with children, was trying to find work in the Springfield area. The other thing that's remarkable about this family is that evidently coal miners made pretty decent money. Robert Wright was able to buy a home. And this is the house that the Wright family would own for nearly 50 years. Now, what's especially remarkable about this home at 2001 South 15th Street, and this is on the southeast side of Springfield, this house was not in a black neighborhood. Almost all the neighbors were European immigrants. Most of them were German. And what's rather fascinating is that in Springfield, Illinois, in 1908, a race riot, the Springfield Riot, is going to occur. It occurred about 1.5 miles away from where the Wright family was located. They could probably see parts of Springfield that were burning. Many of the African-American neighborhoods were burning, but their neighborhood remained untouched. This house became that gathering place where members of the Colored Women's Club of Springfield would gather. It became a social gathering point, and I've been told by some of the relatives of the Wright family that Minnie Wright was the general. She made sure that her boys went to school. She made sure that her kids did well. She was the one who really ran the family in very many respects at 2001 South 15th. William Howard D. Wright, pictured here, was on the football team at Springfield High School in 1921. You'll notice that he's the only African-American player on the team. Springfield played many teams that did not have any black athletes. And one of the things that we found along the way is that William was getting injured frequently in the football games that he was playing in high school. It is quite possible that he was being targeted by some of the other teams, by some of the opposing teams that he was playing. In a worst-case scenario, maybe some of the members of his own team were not protecting him as much as they should have. Now, William was known for being very fast. He was an amazing runner, great speed, but he was a little guy. To give you an idea of how little he was. During World War II, he had to fill out papers because he's going to be in the Quartermaster Corps during World War II. He had to list his height. 5'3.5". When you have to add the half inch, you're short. Okay? 5'3.5". By the way, I think shortest person ever to get into the NFL or so was maybe 5'4", something like that. So, you know, he'd have been right on the edge, right on the cusp there. Back in the day in 1921, William was considered to be one of the best halfbacks in the state of Illinois. He only played football for 2 years of his high school career. His first 2 years, stellar. And then he didn't play the last 2 years. I think this is the influence of his mother, of Minnie. She wanted to make sure that he was going to graduate. And she made sure that he was concentrating on his academics, concentrating on his studies. And so she made sure that her son finished with a high school diploma. Years later, he would get another opportunity to play ball when he decided that he would attend Eureka College. The image that you see at the top, once again, this is Willie Wright during his high school career. Interesting to note, the guy that you see down over here is Carol Hall, who's a Eureka College alum, class of 1927, one of our most famous alums. Carol Hall, also of Springfield, would go on to establish Horace Mann Insurance Company for educators. And so Willie graduated with Carol Hall, who went straight to Eureka College after finishing high school. Willie would wait 4 years to make that move. There also were two Eureka College alums who were teachers at Springfield High School. So it's possible that Carol Hall or maybe some of these Eureka alums would have influenced Willie in eventually making his decision to attend Eureka. One of the other things about the image, and this is the one on the left that you might find fascinating, in the class of 1924, the class that Willie graduated in, there were 9 African-American students. By curious circumstance, all 9 of those were pictured on the same page in the yearbook. So here you have a high school in Illinois, what had been a free state, that is an integrated high school, and yet you find this kind of silent segregation, this kind of silent racism within the institution. All African-American students pictured on the same page. This is one of my favorite pictures that we ran across this summer. This is a picture that shows several members of the Wright family. There were 5 brothers, and 4 of them are pictured here. This is Robert. Robert would eventually become a fireman in Springfield. He became one of the first African-American firemen in the city of Springfield. This was the oldest brother, Thomas. This is Walter. And Walter probably was maybe the closest in age and closest friend, I think, in the family to William. And then this is William here on the end. All 4 of these young men in the Wright family found employment working for the newspaper in Springfield. They basically worked in the circulation department. And here we see an image basically taken probably the early 1940s of the entire circulation department of the Illinois State Journal. Eventually, when William made his decision to come to Eureka College and he would attend fall semester in 1928, he didn't get an opportunity to play ball here. This is something that comes from the Springfield paper once again. There was one bright spot in the play of Eureka College last week, even if Wesleyan's heavier outfit did turn a 50-0 score. Actually, the actual score was 53-0. So they changed it a little bit here, but 50-0 score at its expense. This was the play of Willie Wright at halfback. The little colored fellow who not so long ago was a shining light in the SHS gridiron circles was especially noteworthy. A freshman starting late and getting his first chance for any length of time, Wright displayed plenty of class both on offense and defense. Now, one of the things that William Wright had also planned to do, and keep in mind this is gutsy when you're 5'3½". He was not only going to play football at Eureka College, he also planned to play basketball. Now, that would not come to pass because he made the decision over Christmas break that he was not going to return to college. He was only here for 1 semester. But if he had returned and if he had played basketball, the Eureka College athletic teams would have been tied for being the most racially integrated teams in the Little 19 Conference at that point in history. And just, you know, for comparison's sake, the University of Illinois did not have an integrated football team until 1944. Eureka College had an integrated football team as early as 1921. So in other words, it tells you something really about the culture of this particular institution, about the culture of the place, and also maybe about the culture of some of the surrounding communities. Now, one of the things that you need to understand about Willie that is going to blow you away is that the Wright family had its own story. There was an artifact that belonged to the Wright family. We don't know exactly when they acquired it. We don't know how they got it. But they had their own story, just like every society might have its own cultural creation myth. In the Wright family, there's an artifact that has been passed down through the generations. It is a metal breastplate that actually was used by high priests in centuries past. It has stones on it that represent the 12 tribes of Israel. It is inscribed, and the writing is in English, but it is inscribed. The back of this particular artifact is made out of cowhide. Historical specialists in historical artifacts have looked at this and have said that it is at least 300 years old. And this has been passed on in the family from generation to generation to generation. I had an opportunity to see it this summer. Now, I can't say with certainty what the family story says, and the family story is that we are the descendants of kings. But if you have been told that all of your life, and if you have been instructed that you must get an education, you must represent the family, you must represent the name, because you are important. And this artifact reminds us of that. This is part of their story. So in terms of the providence of the artifact, how it came to be, how they got it, whether the family is a family that's descended from kings, we don't know. We can never know that. But it's the truth that they believe. It's the truth that they believe. And so William Wright would have believed that when he was a young man. Some might have looked upon him and said, you are the descendant of people who had been enslaved. He knew better. He knew better than that. If we switch gears here and talk a little bit about another community, the community of Kewaunee, Illinois. I don't know if you've ever thought about Kewaunee as the promised land. But in the generations following the Civil War, there were some African-American families that decided to move to Kewaunee, Illinois, because they knew that there was work there. The railroads were hiring black workers. And so there were black families that had come up through the days of slavery that after emancipation decided to relocate, and some of these families decided that Kewaunee, Illinois is where they wanted to go. I've got a couple of images here to tell you a little bit about Kewaunee. The first that you see on the right is actually a blackface comedian advertisement that was posted in Kewaunee in the early part of the 20th century. So these sorts of things were going on a regular basis in communities like Kewaunee and others. The image that you see off to the left is an advertisement that was on that was in the Kewaunee newspaper, and it was advertising a Ku Klux Klan rally to be held on Labor Day. And the whole community was invited to come out and to attend this particular event. What's very curious is that right next to this particular Klan advertisement, there was another article that was encouraging freshmen to try out for football at Kewaunee High School. Well, one of the people who decided to try out that year was Lump. Udell Watts Jr. decided in 1924 that he was going to try out for football. In fact, not only was he going to try out for football, he was going to play basketball, he was going to run track. He was going to be a three-sport athlete at Kewaunee High School. And he did all of those things. Ultimately, he was considered to be the best fullback in the state of Illinois. In track, he set the pole vault record. And it was a record that held for many years. An interesting story about that particular episode when he set the pole vault record for the state. He had qualified to go to the state meet. His coach didn't really care for him all that much. His coach was basically racist. And so the coach drove him to the state meet, dropped him off on a rainy day. Just dropped him off. The story is that the coach basically found a place where he could go and drink. Now, yeah, it's prohibition, but you know the story. So the coach dropped him off. You know, good luck, kid. members of some of the other teams supplied him with a jacket so that he would be able to be protected from the elements. They found a pair of shoes that basically were a little too big for him, and the pair of shoes was provided. That day, he would go on to win state record, you know, basically place a state record in pole vaulting, and he got this medal as a result. The next, that evening, by the way, his coach showed up late at night, supposedly drunk, drove him back to Kewaunee. The next day, when the coach and when Lump got to the high school, the coach wanted to treat Lump like he was a celebrity. You know, he did great things. And Lump realized that he had been treated pretty poorly. So what he did is he took his medal and he simply threw it down the hallway. He wanted nothing more to do with that particular coach. In other words, this is a person who was taking a stand. He's a young man. He's only, you know, 20, 21 years old, but he's taking a stand. He realizes he's not going to be treated that way anymore. Now, to understand Lump and to understand where he came from, you have to understand the Watts family. And what you have here are four generations of the Watts family. I'm going to speak quite a bit about this gentleman in a second. This is Arthur Watts, known as Old Arthur. He's going to live to be 108 years old. Not bad. This is Udell Sr. And by the way, just a point to mention about the name Udell. Two things you might find rather interesting. The name Udell actually came from the name of a township in Iowa. When Arthur Watts was moving from Missouri to Iowa and then to Kewaunee, Illinois, he had lived for a time in Iowa. He found this township in Iowa that was named Udell, spelled with a U, U-D-E-L-L, and he turned it into the name Udell with an E and named his firstborn son after this. That name has become a very respected name within the family. To this day, five generations in the Watts family have used the name Udell. About a month ago, Udell Watts III was on this campus. He has a son, Udell IV, and there's a young child named Udell V. So this name has been respected through the years. One other thing that might be rather fascinating here, and I can't make a perfect connection on this, but Ronald Reagan's favorite book in his youth was a book called That Printer of Udell's. And it's a Christian story of a person who finds redemption somewhere in a town in the Midwest. And I would imagine that Ronald Reagan would have been fascinated to meet someone named Udell. And he met him as a freshman at Eureka College. This is Udell Jr., Lump, and the child that he is holding is the gentleman who visited here about a month ago, that is Udell III. Now, to tell you a little bit about Arthur. Arthur was born back in 1837. Andrew Jackson was just leaving the White House in 1837. But Arthur was born in Randolph County, Missouri. His father was Reuben Watts, plantation owner. His mother was a mulatto woman named Sylvia. So his mother was light-skinned, his father was white. Arthur had blue eyes, very light-skinned. Reuben's wife hated this child. She hated Arthur because she knew that her husband had fathered this child. And so the plantation mistress treated Arthur very poorly. He was mistreated throughout his youth. Arthur would become free when he was 28 years old. At the end of the Civil War, 1865, Arthur Watts would be emancipated, would become a free man. Now keep in mind, he had been a slave for 28 years. But what you've got to remember is Arthur would be a free man for the next 80. And Arthur was not going to let those first 28 years define his destiny, define who he was. He was a free man for for 80 years. And he was going to make sure that his children understood that. And he was going to teach his children that through their efforts, through their labor, that they could be successful. But he wasn't going to be defined by slavery. Arthur lives until 1945. He actually dies in a very tragic kind of circumstance. He was crossing a train track in a horse-drawn wagon. And you're probably thinking, this isn't going to end well. Well, it didn't for the horse or for the wagon. They also don't know what happened to his dog. He had a dog that was half dog, half wolf. It vanished. It disappeared. No telling what happened to it. Arthur simply walked away from that accident with a limp. He was limping for the next few months. People saw him working in his garden. He was limping. Folks took him to the local hospital. They said, maybe you need to get that checked out. Well, they took him to the hospital. It was the first time in his life he'd ever been in a hospital. He didn't want to be there. So he was disoriented one night, and he decided to try to break free of the hospital. He's 108 years old. He tried to go down the back set of stairs at the hospital. He fell. He broke his hip, which means more hospitalization. He gets pneumonia. And at the age of 108, Arthur dies. Now, it is possible, can't say this with certainty, but it is possible that Ronald Reagan might have met old Arthur. Because think about it. If your first grandchild is going to college, if your first grandchild is playing college football, as a proud grandfather, wouldn't you want to be there? Wouldn't you want to see this happen? So it is quite possible that Ronald Reagan could have met old Arthur during the time that Mr. Reagan was a student here. The other thing about old Arthur that you might find rather fascinating is that old Arthur became expert at something in his later years, and that was how to make barbecue, how to make some of the best barbecue that you can imagine. And so there is an annual hog festival that goes on in Kewaunee. Arthur Watts was one of the people who helped to get that started. And to this day, they cook tons of pork at this particular festival. And it's a huge event. This is another image of Arthur. You'll see Lump in 1927 here. This is the All-State football squad. The best football players in the state of Illinois in 1927. Most of the players that you see pictured here were going to be going on to top teams in the country. The guy that you see in the center, right over here, many would say the greatest football player of all time, Red Grange. Red Grange took a special liking to Lump Watts. He knew that this guy was the real deal. He knew that he was tough. Red Grange wanted Lump Watts to play football at the University of Illinois. Now, just imagine this. Imagine if somebody's writing a letter of recommendation for you, and it's Red Grange. And he's saying, I want you to take a look at this kid. This kid's got ability. Problem is, the coach at the University of Illinois at that time, Bob Zupke, was notoriously racist and would not play black athletes. He would not have black athletes on his team. And so Bob Zupke decided, no, I will not bring this guy to Champaign. Won't do it. Even though Red Grange thinks that he's a great athlete, we're not going to do it. So a number of businessmen in Kewaunee decided what we are going to do is we're going to pool some money together and help pay this kid's tuition. And the place that we're going to recommend that he goes is Eureka College. And so we got the player that Red Grange thought was the next big deal in college sports. This is who Lump was. Now, if we need to make this point any clearer in terms of who Lump was, I want you to look at this picture. Look carefully at this picture. This is Lump when he's in his 40s. Guys, you can only imagine what it takes to be as developed as you see here. Look at look at the arms on this man. This guy was not huge, but he was tough. He was solid. And I've described him as perhaps the greatest American athlete that most people have never heard of. Now, just to mention something here rather quickly, This coming spring, I'm teaching a course here, which is going to be a special topics course, United States sports history. We've never offered it before, but we're offering it this time. It's a writing course, and so we have to have a writing project that we're going to do. Our class this spring will be researching and writing the Lump Watts story. Because one of the things that Lump did is he had a career after his time at Eureka in semi-pro ball. And nobody's ever researched that or written about it yet. We're going to be doing that this spring. We're going to be working on that particular story. But an amazing fellow, if you look at his size. What Lump eventually would do over the years is he would start a company. He would start Watts Trucking Company. Starts out with one truck back in 1948. By the time of his death in 1990, Watts Trucking would have more than 400 trucks. So this gentleman who attended 1 year at Eureka College eventually forms a company that's going to be bigger than Eureka College. You can do amazing things, okay? Udell III has established a company that manufactures Old Arthur's brand seasonings, barbecue sauce and barbecue seasonings. And you can buy these basically in grocery stores. You can buy them online. The idea is this is the recipe that Old Arthur himself had developed, and it's now still being sold, and you'll find the picture of Old Arthur on the bottles. During his time at Eureka, Udell became sort of like a big brother to Willie Sue. In fact, her son said that Lump was her protector. I don't know exactly what that means. It appears as though Willie Sue was the only African-American woman on campus for the 4 years that she was here. No other African-American woman. And so Lump was her protector. She visited Kewanee. She became friends with Lump's sisters. Ethel was just 2 years younger. Alta was just 9 years old at the time. But she became friends with Lump Watt's sisters back in Kewanee. She visited the family home. They maintained a regular correspondence through the years. Udell III, when he was here, told me that he remembers as a child answering the phone and speaking to this woman, Willie Sue. They maintained connection over the years. The other thing that's interesting about Lump is I found a newspaper reference, December 23rd, 1928, talking about Udell Watts. He was going down to Springfield to spend Christmas break at 2001 South 15th Street with Willie Wright. In other words, you see the connections that are being formed, you see the relationships that are being formed. These students had to look out for one another. They understood their stories. They understood that they had to represent. And that takes us to Willie Sue. The image that you're looking at here is a family photograph of Willie Sue at about age 2 with her father and her mother. Her father was Harry Grant Smith. Her mother was Lulu Geddes Smith. This photograph is taken in Edwards, Mississippi, about 1912. Now, if you remember at the beginning of this talk, I had mentioned that we have to tell stories that are authentic and based on fact and such. When we don't do that, oftentimes we create our own sort of mythology. And let me give you an example. Over the years, we've sort of told a lot of stories about Willie Sue that we thought were accurate. And to a degree, the stories might be just a little bit patronizing because the idea is, aren't we a special place? Because someone like Willie Sue, who would not have had an opportunity for an education in the South, could come here and could get an education. In other words, you know, weren't we sort of special that we could bring in someone like Willie Sue, take care of her, nurture her for 4 years, and give her that kind of opportunity? One of the stories that we've often told about Willie Sue is that when she was a student here, that she would pass notes between Ronald Reagan and his then-girlfriend. And that probably did happen. But when you focus on that particular piece of the story, it's almost as though you're turning her into the perpetual child. rather than looking at her for the person that she was. You see, one of the things about Harry Grant Smith and Lulu Geddes Smith, they were both college graduates. They had attended Southern Christian Institute down in Edwards, Mississippi. It was a feeder school that actually sent people to Eureka College over the years. They had 2 years of college under their belt. They both had attended college at Southern Christian Institute. So you see, by definition, Willie Sue, when she comes to college, is not going to be a student who's not familiar with the college experience. Her parents had both gone to college. And by the way, when she comes here as a student in 1928, her mother was a college professor at Jarvis Christian College in Hawkins, Texas. She could have gone to an all-black school that was affiliated with the Disciples of Christ, but her parents, for some reason, didn't want her to go there. They wanted her to go to this place called Eureka. And there's a reason why they wanted her to come here. They had been here once before. You'll find out why in a second. Now, I've got to tell you one other thing about Harry Grant Smith in this particular photograph in this time, 1912. In the 1910 census, when Harry Grant Smith recorded his data in the 1910 census, Hinds County, Mississippi, one of the things that he had to write down was who his parents were. For his mother, he wrote the name Sue. His mother was a black woman named Sue. For his father, he said, my father was Henry Smith. Henry Smith was a white man who was born in England. I went back and I checked the records. There was a Henry Smith born in Surrey, England, who was a planter in Hinds County, Mississippi. If you look at the 1880 census data, you will find that he's listed as being 57 years old at the time. And if you flip a few pages down in the census records, about six pages from where his name is listed, you'll find a 21-year-old black woman named Sue. Harry Grant Smith's father was an Englishman. His mother, Sue, a black woman who lived on that plantation. They wanted, when they had a child, they wanted a son. And that's why Willie Sue was named Willie. They were hoping for a boy. But I think you know where Sue comes from. Willie Sue. They were honoring the mother. Sometimes historians run across things that are pretty remarkable and are game changers. This is a passport application that was filled out by Harry Grant Smith back in 1912. Harry Grant Smith was planning to go overseas. He was going to do missionary work. On top of that, he was going to bring his wife, and they were going to bring their 2-year-old daughter with them. The place where they were going was Liberia. You see, Willie Sue Smith is going to live for 2 years as a child in Liberia when her parents do missionary work. Now, when I looked at this document, two things really caught my attention, actually three, that were quite significant. First is they filled out this document in Lexington, Kentucky, which is really sort of interesting because this is a family that lives in Mississippi, and they're filling out this form in Lexington. The Disciples of Christ was having a major gathering in Lexington, and so they filled out the documentation in Lexington. The next thing that I noticed is that the name down here is Emory W. Ross. Emory Ross is a Eureka College graduate, class of 1907. Back in 1928, we didn't have these kinds of pictures on the wall, but if we would have had pictures of our most famous graduate, it would have been Emory Ross. He was a star. He was a celebrity. Eventually, he would spend most of his career working in the Belgian Congo, but the first missionary effort he did was in Liberia. They also say to send the passport to Eureka. So think about the gold mine that we've discovered here. Willie Sue and her family are going to Liberia to do missionary work. The passport is going to be delivered to Emory Ross here in Eureka. I went to the local paper, went to the Pegasus. Guess what? The Pegasus of 1912 tells stories about this family coming to town. I went to the local newspaper, the Woodford County Republican, what's now the Woodford County Journal. They tell stories about this family coming into town. There was a ceremony at Eureka Christian Church where this family was blessed. This family was consecrated. This child was anointed as this family was going off to Africa with Emory Ross to do missionary work. Now, it gets even better than that. They're going to cross the Atlantic in 1912. It takes 41 days from the time they leave New York to the time they arrive in Liberia. The reason for 41 days, they spent 10 days in England. That's right, Harry Grant Smith and his wife and child visited England. Eventually, Willie Sue would study English literature. She got her best grades in a class on Victorian lit. She had spent 10 days in England just a decade after the passing of Queen Victoria. Knowing that Emory Ross is connected to this story, one day Tony Glass brought me a stack of documents, the Emory Ross papers, and I started going through those documents thinking there's got to be something in here, there's got to be something in here. And all of a sudden, I ran across another thing that was a gold mine, a letter where Emory Ross is explaining why he had to come back to the United States in December of 1915. Because Lulu Geddes Smith was suffering from something called Blackwater fever. You would get this from complications of malaria. And she had developed this twice in short order. The only way for her to survive was to get her out of Africa as rapidly as possible. And if you're going to remove the mother, you're not going to leave a four-year-old child behind. So Emory Ross, in December of 1914, is going to cross the Atlantic. This is the middle of World War I. There are German subs that are out there in the Atlantic. They're going to cross on a Spanish steamer. The ship gets stopped by a British vessel along the way. There were some Germans on board who were taken off of the ship. And they cross the Atlantic and they come back to America. Emory Ross essentially saves the life of Lulu Geddes Smith and her four-year-old daughter. To give you an idea of how significant the Smith family was, here's an advertisement from 1918. When the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, was trying to raise large amounts of money to support its schools, they held something that was called the Men in Millions campaign. And right over here, they mention Harry Smith by name in this national advertisement, that we want more missionaries like Harry Smith to be able to go out to Africa and other parts of the world. So this guy had become a celebrity. He had become a bit of a rock star in very many respects. And this child who came back to America, who came back to Mississippi in 1914, eventually would move with her parents to Texas when they went there to do to build new church congregations. And by 1928, this young woman would be a student here at Eureka College studying literature. But before she came to Eureka, Willie Sue would spend 1 year back in Mississippi, at Edwards, Mississippi. She studied at the Southern Christian Institute, the same school that her parents had attended. She studied there for a year. Technically, she was really more of a transfer student. We never knew that until relatively recently. She studied Latin and other things in the year that she studied in Mississippi. And so when she came to Eureka College, she was already better prepared than most of those other freshmen who were starting in fall of 1928. By the way, this is the residence hall that she lived in. It was named after her parents. So you see, at Southern Christian Institute, women could stay in Smith Hall. At Jarvis Christian College, the chapel was named the Howard Smith Chapel. It's named after her family and another family. When Willie Sue would become a teacher in Texas, one of the schools that she taught at was the H.G. Smith School, named after her father. Willie Sue knew who she was. She knew where she came from. She was not a blank slate. She had a story. She had a history. She knew who she was. And one thing about Willie Sue that's a little bit different here is that Willie Sue, unlike Udell and unlike William Wright, she would go back to the South. She would live in the Jim Crow era in the Deep South. She would have to face discrimination. And not only would she have to face discrimination based on race, but she would have to face discrimination based on gender. And eventually, as a divorced woman in the South, she would have to face discrimination on those lines as well. For example, when she wanted to become a teacher in different locations, on three times in three different states, Texas, Oklahoma, and Arizona, they made her go back to school to take the same class again and again and again, even though she had already taken it and passed it here at Eureka College. They were putting as many roadblocks in the way as they could to make sure that black educators would not be able to advance themselves. But this is a remarkable woman, because get ready for what I'm about to tell you. She eventually earns a master's degree. Now, you've all heard stories about school integration, James Meredith, University of Mississippi, George Wallace Stand School, House Doors in Alabama, all these things. Willie Sue Smith went from school to school to school to pick up enough credits so that by 1960, this African-American woman had earned a master's degree. Her name should be in the history books. This is remarkable stuff. She's a product of this place, but keep in mind her story is larger than simply the 4 years here. The story is basically her whole life experiences coming together. So what would Dutch have learned? Ronald Reagan never knew his grandparents. All four of his grandparents were deceased by the time Ronald Reagan was born in 1911. He came from a family that was, some might say, a little bit dysfunctional because of his father's drinking problem. There were some rumors of infidelity as well. So it's a family that had some built-in problems, but there were no grandparents. Now, for those of you in here who are college-age students, I just want you to stop and think about how central your grandparents are to your story. Think about how often you talk about them. If they're not doing well, you're not doing well. And when you see them, if they come to visit or if you see them when you go back home, it'll brighten your day. It means something to you. All of these three families were intact families, mothers and fathers, and there were grandparents. And beyond the grandparents, they knew the stories of their great-grandparents. Now, I would venture to guess that if you had to tell a story right now about one of your great-grandparents, very few of you would be able to tell that story. We don't know those stories. But one of the things that's fascinating with African-American genealogy is if you go back about a generation before the before the Civil War, you sort of hit a brick wall. Not everybody can do what Alex Haley did and tell the story of roots all the way back to Kunta Kinte in Africa. What you run into is you run out of names, you run out of story. And so for those individuals who knew their story, who knew who their grandparents were, who knew who their great-grandparents were, they told that story over and over again. And they passed it on. It was part of their family's tradition. Ronald Reagan wouldn't have known that. But he met people who did. He met people whose lives were different in the life that he had known. You see a picture of Mr. Reagan when he was governor of California meeting with Udell Watts. This was on the anniversary of 50th graduation from Eureka College, 1982. You see an image to the right of Willie Sue as a teacher. She continued teaching well into her 70s. The two images at the bottom are images of William Wright and his children, his daughter Dolores Ann on the left, his son Donald on the right. Donald would eventually become a state trooper and would actually be part of the security detail for Governor Thompson back in the 70s or 80s. Dolores is still living today. Now, one of the things I'm going to wrap up shortly, but I want to tell you one story, and you know, sometimes it doesn't all work out perfectly. When we were researching this summer, and we finally found out who William Wright was, came to discover that William Wright had been married back in the 1930s, had these two children, and there was a divorce that occurred about 1938, 39 or so. But as we kept digging, we ran across a name. We ran across the name of Miss Winona. And suddenly I found out, you know, Winona was the person that had been married to William Wright. They divorced. Winona eventually remarries and, you know, had to figure out, you know, what happens down the line. But the most remarkable thing is I was working with a librarian at the university, at Abraham Lincoln Library in Springfield. And I told her the story of what I was working on and said, I think that this woman might still be alive. Miss Winona would be 102 years old. And she said, Miss Winona? My girlfriend knows Miss Winona. She just went into a nursing home 3 weeks ago. So we had an intermediary talk to Miss Winona to see if she would do an interview for this project. And Miss Winona at 102 said she didn't want to do an interview. And I firmly believe when you're 102 years old, you don't have to do anything you don't want to do. Now, I have had the opportunity to interview some of the nieces of William Wright. I have not yet had the opportunity to interview his daughter. I'm hoping that that might be possible. The daughter's about 80 years old. But we need to find out more of his story. He died young. He dies at age 53, 1956. He's buried down at Camp Butler Cemetery in Springfield. There's a lot more to his story that still has to be discovered. And so this is a story about research that's in progress. It's not completely finished just yet. And why do these stories that seem to come together, why do they matter? This is why they matter. We had an opportunity a month ago to bring together sons of two of these families. Harry Stewart came here with his son Sean all the way from Texas. Udell Watts III came here from Rock Island. Neither of these gentlemen had ever set foot on this campus before. They were here for a day, and they started sharing stories with each other. Before the day was over, they were talking about doing family reunions, about having family from Texas come up to visit family in Illinois and Illinois families going down to Texas. They were remembering what their parents had said about these fellow students that they knew back in the day at Eureka College. You see, these are ties that are almost 80 years old now, but they're still very real to these families. And part of what we can do by rediscovering this, by telling these stories, by bringing these things back to life, is we can help these families. We can help them to understand their own story even better, because there is a sense of interconnectedness. Now, if you're wondering, where does this go from here? This was going to be an article. I think it's going to be a book. And it might sound pretentious to say this. I think there's a movie in this. There's a story to be told. Now, here's the good news. For those of you that are history majors, it's going to take a lot more research. You know, there's an opportunity in the years ahead where we can discover some amazing things, and we can discover them here. We can tell our story from here. We can bring these family histories together. We can do that from here. And there's a reason why we have to do it. Because it matters. Thank you for your patience. And if we do have time, I'd be willing to take questions if any of you do have some questions. Yes. Well, I don't know if cajoling is the right word. I started sharing stories with these individuals. I started sharing some of the information that we had discovered. And I remember the first conversation that I had with Harry Stewart. I think the first thing out of my mouth is, you may not believe this, but your mother was a rock star. And I think I had him from Rockstar. Okay, you know, from that point on, he wanted to know more. He wanted to understand more. You know, to think of this in a different kind of way, back in the 1920s, there used to be a museum on this campus which was a mission museum. It was attached to the library that was in Burgess Hall. I believe that the museum was actually located in what's now the Burgess 101 classroom. When Willie Sue was a student here, if she had gone into that museum, she would have found part of her family history being told there. If she went into the library and looked at back issues of the Pegasus or the local newspaper, she would have found part of her family history there. The church that she attended when she was a student here, that's the church where her family had been consecrated on their way to Liberia. Her story was here from the time that she was two, when Ronald Reagan was still in diapers up in Tampico or wherever he'd have been living at that time. Willie Sue's family was already here in this place. They could have sent her anywhere, but they chose to send her here. And so when we started sharing those kinds of discoveries, those kinds of stories, I think the families became more and more fascinated by what we had found. Any other questions? I know I went long. Well, thank you again for coming out this evening. There is a reception. Thanks.